The best way to cut transportation emissions is to make it really easy for people to not have to drive at all.
We mentioned in the US, transportation is the largest source of emissions, and globally it's right behind industry and electricity. And the big challenge there is that a lot of people all over the world have to drive to get to their jobs or to go wherever they're going. Urban mobility, urban design, the idea that if you design cities better, more oriented around walking with commercial storefronts, it really cut down on the demand for driving. And also, a lot of research shows that actually people tend to prefer living in cities like that. There's less air pollution, it's quieter. You can develop public transit systems such as bus rapid transit, e-bikes or shared bikes. You can minimize the size of blocks. If you have to walk a half a mile to get to the next block, and that's where the supermarket is, that's kind of daunting and you might consider having a car. But if it's 100 yards instead, you know, maybe that's something that's more palatable.
One of the most cost-effective ways to get cars out of cities is bus rapid transit. You don't have to build and maintain expensive tunnel networks underground like you do with subways. Plus, the roads they travel on already exist. And now that electric buses have arrived, it makes even more sense.
It's almost like a subway or a light rail, but it's a bus. So it's a dedicated set of lanes without other cars that have a boarding terminal. And so the things that Guangzhou and Curitiba have done well is those buses, they run on time, they have lots of them, they have the dedicated lanes that don't allow other traffic in. They have things like central loading and prepayment. So a lot of times today when you get on the bus, it takes a while for everyone to get on, scan their card or pay the driver and then get to their seat. But good bus rapid transit, actually you pay when you get to the station like you would on a subway or light rail. And then the unloading and offloading of the buses is very fast. And so you can have a system that's built around buses and not light rail and costs a lot less than building a subway system, but you can achieve a lot of the same improvement in non-car travel that you would with a metro or a light rail system. Combining all of those things together into a comprehensive public transit system is really how to make that effective, whether it's a BRT system or it's a subway or light rail.
One tool is simple zoning that encourages dense urban development instead of suburban sprawl.
The urban growth boundary is all about containing that kind of sprawling growth that we tend to see so frequently, especially in American cities. You encourage people to develop upwards and create more dense communities. In the book, we talk about an example in Oregon where there's a very clear boundary where there's just kind of forested area and then boom, you're in kind of a dense and urban area. And of course, when you do that, you also preserve the natural space around the city and you allow access for people to those parks and what have you.
You say, no town is too small. It's never too early to implement that and really restrict where a city can build and expand into.
You're actually starting to see flat out bans on certain types of vehicles in different cities now. In San Francisco, Board of Supervisors said no more non-taxis or buses on Market Street, which is a major thoroughfare.
So what we're trying to do is really minimize the conflict between bicyclists, pedestrians, and private vehicles.
One of the challenges in taking public transit in a city like San Francisco is that I get on the bus, but then I sit in traffic. Mm-hmm. And so if you really not only have the benefit of not having to get in a car, but also it's faster, then you can really encourage people.
The world is rapidly urbanizing. Why are building codes so crucial, especially in places like China, India, and fast growing places like Nigeria?
Building codes are probably the only way to really push forward buildings that are well insulated and that really help preserve the amount of energy needed. And so in the countries you mentioned, in India, Indonesia, as well as a lot of Southeast Asian countries and China, as those economies continue to develop and the per capita income grows, the demand for cooling is growing exponentially. And you add on the fact that we're gonna warm the climate through climate change, and you just are growing the need in the future for cooling in those regions. If you don't have building codes, you get kind of the situation that you have in those countries where you get uninsulated buildings, even in urban areas that are wealthier, they tend to be uninsulated. And so without that insulation in buildings, you really increase the amount of electricity and energy you need to cool those buildings. And building codes require developers to have minimum insulation installed or minimum efficiency of equipment and so on. For one, it reduces people's electricity bills, their energy bills, if they have to use way less energy. It also means you don't have to run it as frequently, so you are saving emissions from the power sector. You can also not buy as big of an air conditioner. Refrigerants in air conditioners are one of the biggest sources of global emissions. And if you're able to buy a smaller air conditioner, you actually decrease the amount of that refrigerant that you need. So building codes really have a lot of potential to improve the demand for cooling in developing countries, but also, for example, to encourage the use of LEDs instead of incandescent light bulbs or even CFLs. The lighting revolution is really incredible and is going to allow a lot of people access to lighting for very low cost that wasn't available even 5 or 10 years ago. And so all of those types of improvements, when they're encoded or enshrined in a building code, you can really get a lot of reduced demand for energy services that has a lot of knock-on effects for energy and emissions.
In California, we have one of the most cutting-edge building code structures. Is what makes ours so effective that continuous improvement aspect?
The Title 24 building code in California is an excellent example of a very effective building code. The code has continued to strengthen over time and drive more efficient, better equipment into new buildings as that equipment has become available, like LEDs, which weren't around when the building code was originally designed.
California's efficiency standards on appliances is also world leading. At the end of the day, it's just best for the consumer, right? It's going to get you better performance. And in California, especially, it helps set the standard for the entire country because our market is so big as well.
Right. So one thing that companies loathe is having to meet multiple standards. And that's partly why you saw a lot of vehicle manufacturers recently agree to meet California standards for vehicles, even if the Trump administration rolls back federal standards, because they'd rather do that than have two different sets of vehicles that meet different standards. So that's true for any standard. So for appliance standards, for things like refrigerators and cable boxes and so on, having a state lead the way on having strong standards is very helpful for driving the market forward. People tend to have what's called very high implicit discount rates. They tend to heavily undervalue future savings. And that's true about buying a new toaster oven, and it's true about buying a new car. And so appliance standards or vehicle performance standards, they build in those cost-saving measures into the available products on the market. So they're actually, they tend to save a lot of money for consumers over time, even if there's a small increase in the price up front. That's why we like them, because there's a lot of these low-hanging fruit, actually cost-saving opportunities out there that we're just not capturing. And performance standards can help ensure that we get those low-hanging fruit options.
The full-length, hour-long version of this interview is available to members of my new video on-demand offering, tdc.video. If you found this interesting, you should definitely check that out. A premium membership not only gets you access to every full-length episode of the Climate Change Solution Show, you help support this project and its goal of bringing these solutions to the attention of as many people as possible. Plus, you get access to my research links from each episode of this show to help you efficiently dig much deeper into these solutions on your own. Until next time, for TDC, I'm Bryce Plank. Thanks for watching.